to episode 47 of Flowing Through Film. This week, we are going to do M. Night Shyamalan, and we're going to be talking about his new movie, Knock at the Cabin, and also as one of his first movies, Signs. I think it's his second movie, maybe?
Let me look. I'm looking at
it. It's one of his earliest. Maybe his third. But we decided to do him just because Knock at the Cabin came out, and we'll start with Signs. I'll ask you guys first.
Hi, I'm Luke. Nice to meet you.
Oh yeah.
You know who we are.
Well, no, you never know who the first. You never know. This could be someone's first episode. I'll introduce my host.
So this is my 47th episode.
This is my 47th episode.
Yeah, hi.
So Luke and Danny.
Hello. And this is actually Shyamalan's fifth movie.
Fifth movie, holy shit.
He did, because I always think of The Sixth Sense as his first movie.
Yeah, me too.
But it's
not.
He did Praying with Anger, and then this movie called Wide Awake.
That, never heard of them.
They look like just studio movies, more like.
Yeah, I think one of those is really low budget, and he shot in India. But...
Okay. Yeah. Either way, Sixth Sense, his first on the same movie.
Yeah.
And then this is his third one. Unbreakable second, this is third.
Yeah, okay.
So, yeah.
So, what are you guys' overall experience in, with Shyamalan, exposure to him first before we actually get into the movies.
Before this week, it was very limited. I think I saw The Visit when I was when I was in middle school at a friend's house. I don't remember much from it. And until this week, the other one other than that is Old. I watched in theaters when it came out, and I was kind of wasn't really a huge fan of that movie. But so yeah, this was this week has kind of been my first introduction to Shyamalan, starting with Knock at the Cabin, and with Sign. Or okay, actually, we're not getting this. I think he's interesting. I'm not a hater. I'm not super high on him.
Yeah.
I disagree with a lot of the hate people give him, because a lot of it's really weird and racist. But
kind of yeah.
Yeah, but he's an interesting filmmaker, which I'll watch everything he comes out with, because it's always. Yeah. It's always interesting.
It is.
That's the main
thing. And ever since fucking The Last Airbender, I think he's been self-funding all these movies.
Well, and then After Earth.
Oh yeah, After Earth also. Yeah,
but yeah, ever since The Visit. Yes.
Yeah, yeah, he's been self-funding a lot of these movies, and they've been making a profit, which is nice. But Danny, what about you?
So, I feel especially me and Blake's age, but maybe even Luke too, I feel all our first experience with Shyamalan being in our age bracket is The Last Airbender. A lot of people just know him as the guy that made The Last Airbender. Ruined, Nickelodeon's Last Airbender that everyone loves so much, obviously. To be fair, he did ruin it. It's not a good movie. It's a very bad movie. But that's the thing. So that's why kind of my first, experience with him is knowing him through that. And that's why I kind of held off on watching his movies. But, I did watch The Sixth Sense, a long time ago. But then after that, when he came back with Split... That's really when I got into Shyamalan again. So, Split, I remember liking a lot, especially for the performances and everything. But basically, since Split, do you guys like Glass?
I haven't seen
it. It's mediocre.
I think Split's better than Glass.
Yeah, so definitely.
But I really like Old, and then...
Yeah, I like Old, too. I think Old gets too much hate for what
No,
it's
it does. It really does, dude. Because, I think... And we're going to talk about
it's
this.
Very interesting.
We're going to talk about this maybe with these two movies, but he... He tries to toe the line between being very serious in his themes, but also being very genre.
Yeah.
And almost showing you that Split. So a lot of people wanted him to be more serious, and they don't like the genre aspect as much. And he can kind of get, at least if you view it in a certain way, maybe too cheesy or too over the top. But that's kind of what I love about it. He almost feels aware of it.
He doesn't take himself too seriously.
Yes, he's aware of the kind of cheesiness he's adding to it at a certain point. And that's why he puts himself in his movie so, almost to make it a joke, at this point.
What you were saying about the happening before the podcast and then trying to make it like a B-movie makes sense, because a lot of his movies kind of feel like B-movies at the end of the day.
Well, you can tell he's inspired by that type of filmmaking,
definitely.
Too. And that really relates to these two movies specifically.
Yeah.
They're one-location movies, but they still feel so exciting.
Oh, yeah.
And they still, and this is, I guess we haven't even mentioned this word yet, but he's really, he's basically a master of tension.
He's very good at keeping
that kind of tension.
He's good at keeping you interested for the most part. Although, we'll get into that Knock at the Cabin. I think he's started to falter in that one a little bit, some parts.
Okay,
but,
yes.
But for me, my first memory of M. Night Shyamalan was Signs, and how much it fucking scared me whenever I was a kid. I still remember that scarring me for life. Well, not for life, obviously, because I love Signs now. But... And after that, I do remember The Last Airbender and hating Shyamalan after that. Until Split, just like you.
So it's, you saw Signs first, though.
No, yes. My first was How Signs and the Sixth Sense. I was like less than 10 whenever I saw Signs for the first time.
But you still had memories of it and stuff?
Yes. Okay. No, yeah, we'll get into it all because I still remember the cornfield scene whenever you see the lake for the first time. Mm. Still remember, like, I remember all these feelings whenever I was a kid, yeah, especially with him, like, with a knife under the door. That one scared the living daylights out of me whenever I was a kid. But no, yeah, like, I had seen The Sixth Sense and Signs before watching The Last Airbender, and then that really was terrible. Yeah. And then Split. But no, I think he's a really interesting director also. I'm a lot like you, Luke. Like, I will watch basically anything he does now. Yeah. And I think I've seen almost all of his movies besides the ones he did before.
Before
Sixth Sense. I haven't seen The Visit, I don't think, but
okay.
Besides that, I've seen the other ones.
Yeah, the ones I haven't seen is Lady in the Water or The Village or The Visit.
Yeah.
Or After Earth. So yeah, those four I haven't seen, and then those two in the beginning.
Yeah, but we can go ahead and just get into Signs if you guys want now.
Yeah, yeah.
So Signs is all about this family on a farm that finds crop circles in their cornfields. Yeah. And this is obviously inspired by real life events that did end up being proven to be a hoax in real life. I don't remember
how the crop circles get there. Then?
It was just, it was like the pranksters that did it, that they thought did it. That's how it actually was in real life. We really watched just people pranking, and then people copycatting. At least that's what the government tells us. No, I'm just kidding. But
this is now a conspiracy episode, basically.
This is now a conspiracy, yes, no.
But that there is a lot of that in this movie.
Yes, where, no, yeah.
Sorry, keep going. No, you're explaining the plot of the movie.
Well, yeah, that is kind of the plot of the movie. It's basically a conspiracy movie.
Yeah, yeah.
Where these people are not wanting to believe that this is real, basically. Like, yes. this can't be happening. Like, Mel Gibson has that line a couple times. Like, this isn't happening, right? Yes. Like they can't believe this is real because this is something that all of us think would be interesting. Like people, I think, at least I don't fantasize about, like, aliens coming or anything, but I think about it, and I think it'd be extremely interesting about, like, what happened. Like what would happen if that actually was real? Yeah. And what would happen if these conspiracies were real and shit like that? And that's literally M. Night Shyamalan had that same thought and just made a movie. Like, that's literally what science feels like. Yes. It's awesome to me. So.
At least, and I agree with you to a certain extent where he does feel like that, where he's like kind of being like, what if those aliens that we all think about in conspiracy-wise, they came? But he doesn't give you the answer that maybe if you think of a typical alien movie, the whole like action battle sequence where you actually meet the aliens, and there is kind of like that in the movie, but it's only just like an alien that's fallen off the ship and, you know, it can't get back, you know. It's not like don't learn the purpose, why they're there, we don't know what what they were trying to take, we really don't learn much about them.
You know, they just know they came to invade, they're hostile. Yes. That's
and
all
like
I really
we learned kind of like they just didn't like water, you know.
That's one of the only major plot points and stupid things about the movie is like these aliens are so advanced that they can get to Earth, they can call it, they want to colonize or take us slaves, make us their zoo or whatever, and they come to a planet where most of it is water and water falls from the sky and that's the only part that is so like incredibly stupid and was otherwise an amazing movie to me. But
I agree, like that's why I don't think it can be taken too literal. Like why I love the movie is because I don't care about the alien part as much as how he's relating it to the other part.
Yes,
of the whole car wreck and, you know, and really like getting over that kind of fear or that weight hanging over your family. That's kind of why I like it so much. And maybe it is like just he's putting it in your face.
It's about overcoming trauma, for sure.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Yes, yes. But yeah, that's kind of why I like also like the almost unexplained aspects, right? Like even like I was telling Luke before the podcast, what I really think the whole movie is about to some degree is not only trauma, but the fact that in this case, I feel like the aliens are more like nature in general. Like the fact that nature can inflict traumas on us, you know, by death.
Yeah.
Either in this case, the aliens, or in her case, just like he says, it's just a random event that happens, or a car wreck.
Well, just around, and it's just, and like in my Shyamalan says in the car whenever he's leaving, like if I would, like no one was on the road, if I would fall asleep 15 seconds earlier, I would just fall into, like run into the ditch and he would be alive. So.
Yeah, exactly.
And that's why I love the quote whenever they're first watching that newscast and Mel Gibson asks Meryl, like, do you believe in, like, there are two types of people, you either believe in miracles and signs or you believe it's all like just chance and luck and shit like that.
We'll get to that. That's actually probably my favorite scene in the movie.
Yeah.
And it really ties that and then to the last scene of the movie too. But honestly, we'll go through this one too. I feel like this one will probably be easier to go through than the other, the Knock at the Cabin.
There's more that happens in this movie.
Let's just go. Because the opening shot, from the opening shot, is actually like an interesting shot. With do you remember? It's from like the window, and we see the outside shimmer, like it's water.
Yeah, yeah.
Like a wave, kind of just hinting at the end, basically, almost like water saves them. You know, water is what saves the planet, almost. But that's how it opens, and kind of then it opens with Mel Gibson, his kid screaming. That's one thing I love about this movie. It just starts.
Yeah.
And that's true with both of them, which is kind of what I love about them. You know, there's no, like, 10 to 15 minutes of, oh, here's some character
development. Yeah, backstory.
Like, the backstory comes through how the characters are actually interacting, reacting in the moment.
Yes,
that's how we learn about that backstory.
It's not like a glass onion.
Yes.
I don't even know what you guys are talking about.
Like backstory. Oh, my God.
I don't even know what you guys are talking about.
Just don't worry about it.
Oh, I'm not going to watch this.
You might at some point. Do you like Knives Out?
Yeah, I like that as well.
Okay. I mean,
sorry, I just had to throw some shade in there.
Yeah, no, but that's a good example, though. Like, this is the exact opposite of that, where it's like, we know why you're here, you know?
Yes.
And so he just starts it right away with the kids seeing the crop circles and everything.
Yeah.
And the whole zoom out, when the helicopter shot, when you first see the crop circles and how huge they are. Yeah, and like, and I kind of like it just from the opening scene, too, because we see the kids are way more willing to believe than the adults are. You know, they're the ones that are lacking, right? Like, and that kind of, and we see it from the, she says something like, are you in my dream too? Like when he shows up to her, he's like, she still thinks she's dreaming.
Yes.
And then he says, he's the one that has to turn his dad's face to actually look at the crop circle for the first time too, which is cool.
Yeah.
Crop fields are just like perfect for horror movies. Anyway.
Oh, we'll get to multiple scenes of that being the case for sure.
So scary. Like,
yes.
Gosh. So this is kind of, you mentioned at the beginning, like, the whole characters don't want to admit to themselves what's happening.
Yeah.
Right? Because, like, we hear Mel Gibson call the sheriff.
Yeah.
And she's like, he's like, can you please just catch the Wilmington brother? Or I forgot their names.
Yeah. And this is actually what ended up being in real life. Like, it was just a couple brothers that went around doing this and pranking people. But
and that's why it makes sense that that's his logical choice that he would think, right?
Yeah.
He's just like, he's almost begging it for it to be true, you know. Oh, please just find these people so I don't have to stress my family out.
And then the sheriff comes over and they actually investigate, and she's like, or I don't remember if it's her that says it or if it's Mel Gibson that says it, but it's like, this is like the way the crops are pushed down is a way that like couldn't really be done by what someone
crushed.
Do this. Yeah, they're not crushed.
They're flat, but they're not crushed.
Yeah.
So like, how could just, you know, three guys just doing that, how could they have done that?
Yeah.
You know. And that's like kind of the first sign. They just don't want to admit it.
Yeah.
You know? And honestly, that's why it's a perfect name for the movie, because you'll start saying that throughout the movie too when we describe stuff. It's just like, oh yeah, this is a sign that'll come up later and stuff.
Yep, and then we get and then after that's the night scene, I'm pretty sure, after that.
The scene, the shot of the seeing the alien in the like through the was it through the window or whatever like,
when they see it standing.
Yeah, yeah, that's
a creepy shot. Because she's in bed. She calls her dad. I don't remember what for. I can't remember if she had a bad dream or something.
Or was her water, wasn't it?
It was her water. Yeah, because that's a huge part of the movie. Yes, obviously, it's like anytime she has old water, she doesn't want to drink it.
I didn't really get that. Is that
that's definitely a thing. Some people are like that, where if water can taste old. To some people.
Okay.
I don't really care personally, but
and that's it actually makes more sense when I was thinking about it the second time, because both of the kids have their little what you would see flaw actually saving them.
Yeah, they're their
with the girl
quirks.
Well, it's not a quirk for him.
Well,
it's asthma.
His isn't actually like
for her,
a condition.
But still, you can see it both the same way. It's just something they can't control. You know, it's just like it's basically something they're born with almost.
Yeah.
But yet, that's what saves them at the end.
Yeah.
And that's why it seems more dumb with the girl, because it does, like, that's why the whole alien thing does, it seems kind of dumb with these aliens just being defeated by just water, but
yes,
the whole, like, him being saved by the poison gas because he's having an asthma attack, I really like that.
Oh, yeah, no, that's really good.
And, you know, that's going way to the end, but
that's going way to the end, because the shot of you seeing just the alien standing on the chimney, and then, like, Mel Gibson's reaction shot of him, I think he just, like, takes a step back, and, like, his eyes get, like, real big, like, So Mel Gibson, obviously a problematic person in real life, but in this movie, fucking
so
insane.
Good.
Like, he's a very charismatic, great actor. I don't think anyone can deny that.
And a great director too, honestly.
And honestly, a great director.
Yeah. I think this is the first movie I've ever seen him in.
Really?
Acting or directing?
Yeah,
or?
I think so.
Really?
Unless he has a cameo in some other movie, that's who you're talking about. Literally, almost gate. Put me in a cardiac arrest, I swear to God.
Oh, yeah, dude,
it was awful.
It's so good.
Actually, no, it's just
he just has the perfect, like...
It's awful.
he just has the perfect acting stern face of a guy that you believe was a priest, but that also quit.
Yes.
You know, like, oh, this kind of, like, stern...
Yeah. Well, yeah, he just does, like, the kind of mopey kind of...
But it's, like, stern, too, though. Yeah. It's, like, he's still, like, shoulders up, you know? It's not mopey, like, shoulders down. It's,
but, like,
it's,
like, almost, like, the tone of rejecting... his voice, he kind of does it really well, though.
He does.
It has a hint of that, I feel like.
Of just, he's definitely dejected. Like,
You can tell he's a soft-spoken man, for sure. Oh, yeah, yeah. You can get that, his old life. Through the way he is now, like you said earlier. Yes,
exactly.
But you can tell he is broken by something, because at this moment we don't know what it is, really.
Yes.
I don't know if the kids at any point say, before we actually go to M. Night where M. Night Shyamalan's cameo happens, like, that's whenever I think he first vocalizes that his wife, like, how she died. I think the kids probably say something earlier in the movie about their wife not, or about the mom not being there and stuff like that, obviously. So, but
I from what I remember, I feel like it's when the sheriff says something about it.
Yeah, it might be whenever the sheriff says something
to the brother, or like, it was so nice for you to come after her, after she died.
Oh yeah, for sure.
But I
I thought he was his son at first, honestly.
Dude, yeah, because that's another thing, like how you said where the movie just starts. You can obviously think Mel Gibson and Joaquin Phoenix are two different marriages almost. Like he's just a son from a different marriage or something like that.
I feel like he's also old enough to just be his son, though, in a way. If you think of, like, he looks really young, honestly.
He does look really young.
But
I think it's kind of, it's saying, like, it's a younger brother, older brother, but they do have a huge age gap between them, obviously, it's kind of implied like that. Because at the end... I keep going to the end, but the end does tie everything together in a lot of ways, too. Because remember at the end where he tells his brother, I don't want to see your eyes ever like that again. It looked like you gave up or something like that.
Yeah.
And basically does sound like, the way he's saying it is like if a son said that to his father, too. Yeah. Basically, you know, like, I don't want to see that from your eyes. You know, it kind of scared me. Like,
yeah.
And that's why their relationship is really interesting.
No, it's really good. Like it's a great part of the movie is their relationship, because you see a lot of growth in Mel Gibson in this movie, honestly.
Yes.
I mean, a lot happens in the movie, as we'll get into. But specifically after this scene, he goes to get Meryl. I think this might be not our introduction to Meryl, but this is like his first big scene where they're like outside chasing the alien, because they think it's the brothers. Yeah, and they're like, come with me, and we're going to catch these guys in the act while they're doing it. Oh, and then they're just outside, and they both go around the house, and then they can't
find him. What Mel Gibson was saying, too, was hilarious.
I'm going to kick your butt.
Because Meryl was like, you got to cuss and stuff to scare him. And he's like, I'm really angry.
No, and then when they find out, like, they both run around both sides, and they still don't see it, and then they see it on the house.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a creepy scene.
No, and, like, they're running around the house. Like, Meryl, we find out, after this scene, I'm pretty sure, is what used to be, like, a huge baseball player. He was a really good athlete.
Minor league baseball player.
A minor league baseball player. A really good athlete. So, he thinks he can run really fast. I know he says that. He says that about himself. So,
which is kind of
funny. It's kind of funny that how he's just, like, humble bragging, like, fast. I should have caught him. But yeah, because they meet there, and then they just look up and see that something jumped on the house. And then, literally, like, 5 seconds later, we see the swinging. And just something ran off in the cornfield.
Yep.
So good. Because they're just standing there looking up, and then all of a sudden they just hear the swing set going, like, swing. And then, like, they look over and it's just swinging. And something ran off.
It's really good. And, like, it's the whole, like, both are in this scene and they see everything that happens. And yet their first explanation after it happens is they still have to find, it was still the brother somehow. You know, that's still kind of their first, like, they still can't accept it, really.
Yeah, because the next scene is actually whenever the sheriff comes over.
Yep.
And the sheriff, and she's talking to Meryl, and Meryl's saying, we have to find, like you said, the people that did this, the guys that did this.
Yes,
she says, why you assume it's a guy?
Yes, yes.
Because someone came into the town earlier and was like, this is such a small town thing, like, they were cussing because they didn't have the cigarette pack, and that's what made her think about it. Like, it might be them that's doing it.
And apparently, Meryl said, like, he said also, it has to be a man, because I'm really fast, and he ran fast.
Yeah, exactly,
And all she says is, leave your possibilities open.
Yeah.
Basically, kind of hinting about what's going to happen. Like,
oh, yeah.
It's not a man, you know? No, but yeah, she's kind of good at... She basically doesn't show up after this.
She shows up a few times after.
Okay.
She gets off big time Frances McDormand vibes to me.
That's honestly what I was thinking.
Yeah.
There,
Fargo.
Yeah.
Honestly,
yeah.
That's what
No, she shows up more in the flashback scenes later.
Oh, yeah, that's right. The flashback scenes.
Yeah, because And honestly, because I rewatched it, I've seen this twice. I watched it last week and I rewatched it today. And rewatching it again, like, it does, like...
I finished it.
It almost feels like an Ozu movie, where, because the characters on screen aren't telling you, like, how their relationships happen, at least towards the beginning.
Yeah.
In terms of, like, the wife has died and stuff like that. You kind of just have to just see it by the way they're reacting to it in the moment, daily life stuff.
I feel
that,
yeah.
When
you said Ozu at first, I was like,
no, but it's just that spot.
It actually makes a lot of sense.
It's not like the characters are not going to be like, oh, my wife died.
Yeah.
If it does happen, it's going to be from a third party character that comes and says it, you know, because none of the characters, it's almost too close. Basically, what this whole movie's about, it's like, they can't let go of that.
They're not
going to
give
you
a narrator who's going to tell you everything.
Yes, or something like that. Yeah. It has to be like, you have to see that based on how they're acting in the movie.
Yes.
And like, one of my favorite scenes is, we'll get to it later, honestly, but it's the dinner scene where they make the food, for their last meal, basically.
Yeah.
That scene would work, even if there was no horror element.
Yeah.
If it was only just their wife had died, or his wife had died, and they were still trying to eat dinner after it.
Yeah.
All of that stuff would still work.
Oh, it definitely worked.
You know, and that's why the movie works so well, because there are a lot of moments like that in the movie where...
It is, yeah, because I know there's another moment where... this is one of my favorite shots in the movie. I don't remember exactly where it happens, but we just see Mel Gibson through a crack in the door, and he's on the phone, and then the camera pulls back after he's done talking, and all you see is just a dress in the corner, and him a little out of focus in the background, obviously implying that's his wife's dress, obviously.
Yeah.
I don't remember exactly where in the movie it happens, but...
It's like right before they like open the book and they see all the Dr. Bimbus.
We're
actually kind of close to that, but
we are kind of. One of the next major things that happens after this is we get the report that the animals around the town are acting weird, and we go back to the house.
Okay, well, we missed one thing. The end of the scene where like the sheriff has come over and everything. This is where we find out the aliens are real, which is a they turn on the TV.
Yeah.
Because the daughter comes up and says every channel on the TV is playing the same channel.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
She's
watching Dexter.
Yeah,
she's
watching
Dexter's Laboratory before that scene.
Was this the one where the bird was dropped into the ground?
No, this is before that.
The original thing where they just are starting to see lights in the sky, basically.
Okay. Because there's multiple...
Or actually, it might just be the crop circles we'll be hearing around the world.
Yeah, there's multiple news broadcasts, basically.
That's another Shyamalan theme with both of these movies, is people finding out about the truth through the news, which is obviously how we feel.
And I do really like it. I like this one, honestly, because a lot of times it feels like they just turn on the news. At least, honestly, Knock in the Cabin is like this, too, where they just turn on the news and it's just like, obviously, like I said, it's breaking news in Knock in the Cabin, so it makes sense. But in this one, it's something so significant that it's playing on every channel.
Yes.
And so it's literally happening now. Yes. Like, it's breaking right then.
Yes.
So it just makes a lot of sense that something, like, because something, if something like that actually happened, it would be plastered on everything. Like, you wouldn't be able to see anything else.
And
the world would stop, like it did in the movies.
It does.
He captures that very well.
Oh, I love that. Because, like, you could see how another person might make this horror movie and have a lot of the elements, but without it happening everywhere.
Yeah,
it's like, oh, it's only happening to me. Like, why is it? Like, they go to the town and everyone's like, oh, everything's normal, you know? Like,
yeah.
And his movie's like, no, everyone's experiencing the same thing. We're just seeing it like in this one local place.
Yeah.
Okay. And that's what I really like. Like, he's trying to make it feel like this could happen. It is actually happening in the world.
Yeah.
And that's why a lot of people find out about bad events through the news, because that's how in real life how we find about bad events. You know,
yep.
We're turning on the channel.
Yep.
Another filmmaker that kind of does that is Terrence Malick. Think about Badlands. They never...
Yes, everything's
from
newspapers or something.
Yeah, everything's... And the only time you see it is in a black and white news reel, basically, recounted by... Anyway. Love Mal.
And Mal Connection, the guy that shot Badlands, shot this movie.
Oh, yeah. Okay, damn. Actually, yeah.
Yes.
Okay, yeah, that makes sense.
I forgot his name, but... I'll look it up.
Shout out to him, regardless.
I think
makes
it was
sense,
2G
though,
Fox.
This honestly, we should have said this at the beginning, but to me, this is, like, his best shot movie.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Like,
ones I've seen before so far.
Yeah,
I haven't rewatched The Sixth Sense recently, so that one might pair up. But I
watched Sixth Sense this week, and I think this one's
okay.
Better,
nice,
but,
nice.
Yeah,
because this one's just like it's framed and shot so well. Like
it is, dude. Like all the shots of, and this kind of relates to what we were just talking about. All the shots of them watching TV.
Yeah.
Basically, all of them are amazing. When all four of them are just huddled around watching, just like waiting for something bad to happen on the news.
Literally.
Next, you know? Or the different shots of Joaquin Phoenix just like staring at the screen. Like,
yes.
And this is where the whole conspiracy thing really comes about.
Yeah.
Like, a lot of these scenes would still work even if there was no alien attack. you know, where it was just a family going crazy after a horrific event happened to them.
Yeah.
And now they're just going into all these crazy conspiracy theories because of it.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, and one of my favorite parts about the first time we see them, at least, is they're all watching intently at the very beginning. They cuts, and it's the middle of the night, and both the kids fall asleep, and Mel Gibson and Joaquin Phoenix are just eyes plastered, still just on the TV.
Yeah.
And I think this is whenever they actually have that scene of talking about, do you believe it? Or there are two types of people, the ones that believe in signs and miracles, and the ones that believe it's just all happening by random chance. And then Meryl's saying he believes in signs and miracles.
Yep. So, okay, so I wanted to mention the scene right before this, before the kids fall asleep, because to me it's one of the best scenes, is the scene where, remember, the kid wants to record what's happening because he's like...
Yeah.
He's like, this is science, this is going to be the future of science or something. He says, this is the history of the future of the world. Don't you want your kids, your grandkids to see that you were there?
Yeah.
And she says... she still doesn't want it because it's her ballet recital.
She just says, my ballet recital.
Yes, yes. And I love this moment because both of them are right.
Yeah.
Like, in the future, let's say their grandkids were wanting to see it. You could see them being interested in both things.
Yeah.
You know, their grandma's ballet recital when she was a kid. Or something that happened that was a horrific event, you know. And both of them could have equal value.
Yeah.
And that's kind of what he's saying in this movie, too. Like... Like an event that happens to everyone, like a natural disaster, that's one way for a disaster. But there's also another equally natural disaster of like just your wife dying in a car wreck.
Yeah,
and it's almost the same kind of world end, but one of it's very personal, which is for Gibson, and another it is like universal. You know, more collective. Yeah. You know, just and he, but he's saying it in terms of the person, it still impacts them the same way.
Yeah,
and that's kind of what Gibson is going through, like almost twice. That's why he's having all these flashbacks. You know.
Yeah.
But
and that's definitely correlated with that, with the ballet recital. For
yes.
Sure.
No, exactly. That's why it's like both of them are equal in value. You know.
To her. Yes.
Yes, to her.
Which is why he's trying to say it. Now. Yeah.
But I'm saying just to even to Gibson or anyone, right? Like the reason why the natural disaster is bad is also like the. Is because we value the things like the ballet recital.
Yeah.
You know? But that's why I really love that moment, too.
Oh, yeah. No, that's a good... And then it just ends... It is kind of funny, because it's like, Uncle Meryl, I'm using your tape. It's just a swimsuit on.
Like, okay, yeah. We can get rid of that.
Yeah, exactly. It's fucking hilarious.
No, but then when they fall asleep is what leads to this kind of conversation that kind of frames the whole movie of Gibson saying there's, like, two types of people. There's those that just believe in luck as luck, and then those that believe... Basically, no luck. There's no coincidences, right? They're all, everything is a sign.
Yeah.
And there's basically two different ways to kind of view the same world, you know? Well, what do you guys think of the scene? Like,
well, this is an amazing scene. It's one of the best, honestly.
Like, do you agree with Gibson? Because he kind of says at the end of the scene, I'm with the...
I can't remember Meryl's reasoning, because Meryl had a reason for why he was with
the sign. Oh, his reason's so good, dude. Like, because his reason is kind of what I've been talking about earlier. His reason is a very personal reason. Where he says the reason why he
believes in miracles. Oh, yeah. The girl almost throwing up. Yes.
And from a personal perspective, from his perspective, that is a miracle.
Yeah.
Because he already says, that could ruin how I, you know, kiss girls for the rest of my life. Which could be a terrible thing, you know? So from his perspective, that is a miracle. But, like, if someone else is hearing that story, they wouldn't see it as a miracle, you know?
Yeah.
So that's kind of what he's saying. Like, the way you view, the way you choose to view the world is a way, is only, like... Basically, how you can see signs, if only if you believe in them in the first place.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And that's kind of how the movie ends, with Mel Gibson having to believe that what his wife said to him was a sign, which is what saves them. You know? And it becomes in a literal sense, but that's kind of what the whole point of the movie is. It's like he has to believe first before he can actually see the signs.
Yeah.
Or else he'll just keep saying, oh, it's some logical reason, it's some this or that, you know? And I was telling you guys before, like, this is one of my favorite aspects of films in general, is... how it can deal with basically miracles and signs in all its different ways. And I'll definitely talk about it more in the future, but it's kind of why I love this movie. And that's why I love this scene so much, too, because it makes you really think about that. But the scene ends with Gibson basically deciding that he's in group two, right? And that's kind of what the whole movie's been implied. His wife died, he left the church, you know? And it makes sense, right?
Because multiple times before this, people have been calling him father. And he's been telling them not to.
Oh, there's been some funny scenes, too, like in the drugstore, with a girl being like, Father, can I have something to confess? He's like, I'm not father anymore.
She's not father anymore.
But can I still please confess? And he just doesn't say anything. She still, confesses.
Okay.
Yeah, but, because you can tell he at least still feels somewhat obligated to listen to these people, because Especially if you're from a small town and you just quit like that. Like, you can't really replace that. That's how everyone sees you. Yeah, that's how everyone sees you. So, yeah.
Yeah.
It's hard to get away from that. It's hard to get away from the labels you're given. So, I don't know if that's part of the movie either, but...
Okay. It's interesting because I literally watched another movie that had kind of the same aspect where there's a caster character that's not a pastor anymore.
Which movie?
The Grapes of Wrath.
Oh, yeah, that is.
I watched that, like, it was confusing. I was like, wait, I just watched a movie that's like, what's going through this as well, some character.
I can see M. Night Shyamalan being a big Grapes of Wrath guy. Grapes of Wrath is a classic, so.
It's okay.
I didn't love it I watched it. But...
I still haven't seen it.
Anyway,
what happens after this scene?
But I do want to say how the scene ends. Oh, yeah. Because it ends with, what I love is because Gibson is basically saying, he says at the very end, we're all on our own. And that's what he tells Joaquin Phoenix. And then right after he says we're all on our own, it cuts to a shot of the family together. And that's kind of just the whole, like, basically Shyamalan telling Gibson he's wrong about what he's saying. Because the whole point of the movie is, like, Gibson feels like he's alone, but when he realizes that he actually has his family with him, that's really when the movie changes, you know? So almost that cut is, like, basically Shyamalan being like, see, you're not even alone in the moment. You still have your family here. Yeah. But Gibson's saying he's alone, right? Just because of that one loss. But that's because he can't leave the past, kind of.
Yeah. You know,
the whole weight of this movie. But, yeah, so that's why I love the scene. It's my favorite scene in the movie, but we can keep going.
It's one of mine, too, yeah, for sure. I feel like the dog dying happened before this, then.
It does.
Because we definitely missed that part, because...
That's right after they see the sheriff comes.
Yeah, because that's just another part where the kids are having to, like, do things that normal kids wouldn't have to do, you know? Like, they're having to deal with things.
No, they're being treated like adults, too.
Yes, they are. Like, M. Night Shyamalan treats them like adults because they have gone through shit.
Yeah, so, they already have. Yes. Yeah. They've already experienced a lot of pain already, too. Yeah. That's really good point.
They've already had trauma. Why not some more?
Yeah. No, yeah. But, well, yeah.
So that's what horror movies are.
That's what horror movies are. Basically. All the trauma.
But, yeah, no, that was earlier, but... Basically, because right after that scene where they talk, that's the first time we see a flashback with the wreck. It cuts to the wreck just a little bit, where he's like, it's like we see an ambulance and he's walking towards the car, and then it cuts away.
Yeah, he wakes up.
But that's really the first hint of, okay, there's these two parallel stories, kind of.
He kind of does that in Knock at the Cabin, too.
He does, at the end.
Oh, with the...
Well, just with their... Because they both have alternate... Or they both have flashbacks.
Yeah, they both do.
Yeah,
because
One of the characters is involved in one of the past.
Yeah.
We'll get to that.
Because
then he... Basically, what's the next big scene? Because there's a lot of, like... the sheriff tells them to go to the city to get their minds off things and stuff.
Yeah.
I don't remember.
The next big scene is when they look through the book, Dr. Bimbo's book.
Yeah. Well, the funny thing is this the scene where Mel Gibson just walks in and they're wearing the tinfoil hats? I'm pretty sure that's in the Dr. Bimbo scene for the first time. I thought both the kids were reading the Dr. Bimbo's book, and they both had the tinfoil hats on. Because there's another funnier part later where they add on.
That's when Joaquin also has it, and they're all three sitting on the couch.
No, but see, the two kids have it in this scene.
In this one,
too.
You're right.
Yeah, but there is the next scene.
That's kind of what I'm saying. The kids are the first to believe.
They are.
You know, even if in this way they're wrong, but still, they're the first ones to believe.
Yeah.
But yeah, this is where they literally see their house being burned.
Yeah.
With the corn, and there's like, and then he just says, "Oh, it's just Dr. Bimbo," you know. Just can't be
serious. Well, I mean, and the thing is, he named him Dr. Bimbo. On purpose. Like Bimbo, like it literally sounds like Bimbo. Like what? Yeah, exactly.
No, but he's even giving you a reason. Like, even if you see the sign right in your face, you will find another reason to convince yourself it's not a sign.
Yeah.
Which is the name. Even if you're fucking seeing your house, like it literally looks like your house being burned.
Your house being burned, three dead bodies in the front yard. This is what I brought up last week, I'm pretty sure. Maybe off air. But I said how in Knock at the Cabin, I loved the use of like their drawings depicting what was going to happen. And this one's the very similar thing to like, there's drawings in these books of like the literally visions, what's about to happen. Yeah, literally visions.
Yes,
yeah.
No, he loves that idea too.
Yeah. Of people being shown things beforehand.
Yep, signs.
Signs, yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, okay, so what happens after that?
We're mostly just watching things happening now.
He goes to visit Ray. This is where he.
No, yeah, he gets the phone. Well, he gets because this is the phone call where it pulls back. Is this the one where it pulls back and you see the wife's dress? I can't remember.
Yes, I flipped it. They all. This is when they open the book and stuff, and that scene ends with a jump scare of the phone ringing.
Yeah, that's right.
Is then what you're talking about.
Yeah, and that's why, and it pulls back because Ray's calling it. Obviously, it's supposed to say like, that's the connection right there. Night Shyamalan actually voices it in the next scene. This is also, I think we did maybe miss a scene before where the bird's head got crushed and like they all like all the aliens technically disappeared. I think that newsreel might have happened beforehand. That might have happened just a little bit beforehand because that's not a huge part. It's mostly just this, them saying they're still here. They could be anywhere.
Except for, I do love that scene though. Force field. Because it's like Joaquin Phoenix had his like kind of most like conspiracy looking craziness where he's like, in the closet. He's in the closet and he's right next to the TV, like staring like eyes wide open. And then the dad, or Mel Gibson, opens it, and he's like, "What time is it?" And he's like, 11 a.m.
Yeah.
And you're like, you don't expect it to be 11 a.m. based on like how he's like
watching. Yeah.
And he's like, "I've been watching all night, like all these theories and stuff." Yeah. Like, it would make that scene would make sense even if there was no aliens.
Oh yeah.
You know.
Oh yeah, it definitely would. But the scene that we just got done talking about, where he gets the call from Ray, he goes under the cupboard again, where Meryl still is, grabs his jacket. And then says, "I'm leaving," and then Meryl asks him where, and he's going to Ray's house. And then this, I'm pretty sure him going to Ray's house is intercut with our first scene, because we see the alien appear on video before Mel Gibson finds the pantry, or like before Ray tells Mel Gibson about the pantry. Because this is like, it's simultaneously happening, these scenes. Because he's going to talk to Ray. They have that really emotional scene where like they have that heart-to-heart, like Ray basically saying, "I'm sorry for what happened," and him... about like what, and this is whenever we figure out he ran over his wife and like that's what happened, and this is why Mel Gibson doesn't believe
in miracles. Some of his best acting in the movie too, because
for both of them because
when at the scene ends with him basically apologizing and kind of wanting forgiveness almost, you know, and he like Mel Gibson can't say anything. He doesn't say anything in the movie. He kind of just says yes or okay or something.
But he basically says okay.
He's speechless.
It's that thing where, especially since he's a man of God, you're supposed to forgive no matter what. Exactly. Especially if it's as heartfelt as Ray.
He knows what he should be doing.
Almost. Exactly. And you can see that in his face. That's why Mel Gibson's performance in this movie is amazing. Dude, because you could tell that he knows the serotonin. Like, he knows what Ray wants to hear. He knows that his apology is extremely heartfelt. And he still can't say, I forgive you. Exactly. Like, he still can't say it.
Exactly. Yeah. He's still rebelling, basically.
Yeah.
In his own way.
In his own way.
Did the movie ever say, like, how long ago the wreck was?
No, I don't think so.
I'm not really sure.
Like, it might. I don't remember if it does.
Okay.
They don't make it a big part they did say it.
I think it's six. They say it's 6 months since he left the church. I know that.
Okay.
So it might have been around 6 months.
So it's very recent.
But that's a good point, though, because that scene ends with Ray saying, "I put it in the pantry."
Well, yeah, before they even had that heart-to-heart, he's like, Ray's kind of just rambling in his truck because he's really scared. Once I figured out it was inside the house, I locked it in there. And then they have that heart-to-heart, and then he tells him afterwards, it's in the, I locked one of them in the pantry. But before even that, this is cut with Meryl, like, watching wide-eyed the first time, this Portuguese family filming at a party. And I'm feeling like Meryl in this part where he's just like, "Move, children, move, vamanos," get out of the way. It's so fucking funny because he's just like, they're all in the way of the camera. And so, like, this is the best part, and why M. Night Shyamalan is so good at building tension is he takes his time. He doesn't just show you immediately. Like, it opens up with him pointing out one window, and everyone's looking there, and they're like, "Oh, I think it moved over there." And then like I'm assuming it's the dad filming. He just like slowly walks through the house because they are looking through the front door now and not like out of the side window, so it takes time to walk over there. Then all the kids are in the way, and that's whenever Meryl's like, whenever Walking Kids like, "Move, children, get out of the way." And then he finally gives you the shot that you're you're waiting to see. And it's a great shot, it's man. Like, it's so scary. That's the jump scare that gets me.
People I follow on Letterboxd have basically said, like, the scene scarred me as a child, basically.
It
like,
did. Gave me nightmares. This is one of the scenes that scarred me. This scene, because it was this scene, and then the pantry scene happened right after, and I was like, dude, I can't do it anymore. Like, 11-year-old me was like, I'm out.
Did you finish the movie?
I did. But, but I was scared as shit. This movie gave me nightmares for a while, so.
But this is also another example of, even the alien itself, the first time they see it, is through a TV.
Yep.
Right?
Okay. Yep.
Through breaking news. He just really loves that idea, like,
yeah, and
which makes sense because he wants it to feel like a real even if the actual event if the actual event being explained is an alien, he wants it to feel like if it was a natural disaster or yes. You know, like everyone would experience it at the same time. So he loves the finding out through the breaking news on TV. Yes,
and Joaquin Phoenix in this part is phenomenal.
Yes,
because he's like whenever he sees it for the first time, he just backs all the way up to the back of the closet, and his hands just over his mouth like that, and then he just gets really close to the TV again. He's just watching really closely, and we can see that like this is whenever the alien we see it's like can change its skin color, and that also plays a part later on in the movie a few times.
Yeah, it does,
but. This is their cut with what my favorite scare is in the movie, where Ray tells Mel, or I can't remember his name in the movie, but he tells Mel Gibson, I can lock one in the pantry. And so Mel Gibson walks in there, he sees something moving in there, because you can see the shadow moving under the door. That's one of the best parts about it, honestly. Another great reason Shyamalan's great attention is because of shadows, his use of shadows.
Shadows, and also the fact that us audience members knows what the alien looks like.
Yeah.
But he doesn't know what it is.
We're ahead of him.
Yeah, we're ahead of him. Yes.
We're ahead of him in this movie.
Yes.
And it's so funny because this is another part where he's kind of doing how earlier, like whenever Meryl was telling him to act angry, he's going like, I'm with the police. We already caught all your friends. We have them in the paddy wagon.
Yeah.
He's like getting onto his sauce. He's like, so you see your little conspiracy's over, I'll give you the same deal I gave to them. And then like nothing happens at all. And then he almost leaves.
And he comes back.
He comes back, gets the knife, looks under, almost leaves again because he couldn't see anything. And you can tell, like, this is another great Mel Gibson acting scene, because you can tell he's scared. Like, he doesn't want to get too close to the door, because, like, he's so far away that he just barely sticks the knife under it can look like that.
Yep.
And then he almost gets close to the door, and then he almost walks out.
Yeah.
And then he's like, no, I gotta see it. And so, it's the curiosity. The curiosity kills the cat, you know? And so he grabs the knife, goes
especially
back
that
under.
Especially he's using a knife, too.
Yes. Goes back under, and the hand just... Reaches out, and he just cuts his fingers off. But, dude, that jump scare is the one that got me the most whenever I was a child. Okay, like, oh, my God.
Okay, yeah, I can see that.
And there's another really good jump scare coming up, too, at the end.
At the end, yeah. I think I know what you're talking about, but we'll get there. But, yeah, when he comes back from this scene, basically they've all seen the alien now, them through the TV, him through, you know, this whole thing.
Yeah, because they come back, he just looks over, and Meryl has the temple.
They're all sitting
the
in the same position.
Yeah.
And I love how short to the ground the couches are,
because
it makes them put their hands on the knees in, like, that weird position.
Yeah.
You can tell he like, loves
that. Dude, like, I love this scene so much, because Mel Gibson, the first time he walks in and sees his kids like that, the first time... He has the same face as he has this time, like, really? Like, this is what we're falling to? And then he sees Meryl has it this time, and his face is just perfect, and he goes and sits on the stairs because he just can't deal with it right now.
Except for, this is where also Gibson is starting to, he wants to have other reasons. Because I love this part, too, because this is when he asks the son, so what else did Dr. Bimbo say in his book?
Bimbo.
And then he tells him something about, like,
were they hostile? Yeah.
Yeah, there's two ways. They could either be studying us or they're hostile.
Yeah.
And then
they could either be furthering the galactic community or some shit like that.
Something like
that. Like the spirit of exploration.
And then the way Gibson says this, it's so funny. Like, it's this whole thing of, like, even if we don't have an answer, we search for an answer just to give us self comfort. And he says, how could anyone possibly know that information? It's ridiculous.
Yeah.
What else did it say, though?
Yeah.
Right after that. Yeah. He, like, still wants to know. Like,
yeah.
First of all, because some of the book is still coming true. But,
oh, yeah.
But it's more that fact of, in the absence of if we don't have any answers, we'll hear anything.
Yeah.
You know, it'll give us some comfort if at least someone's, like, thinking of some kind of closing for us, you know, some closure for us.
Yeah.
Even if the guy's name is Dr. Bimbo, even if he keeps saying, that's stupid, like, how could he even know that? Like, his next sentence is, oh, but what else does it say?
Yeah, but what else does it say?
No, but yeah, so this is basically, and then this is also where Gibson, and then after that he says, I also heard another interesting, he doesn't say interesting, but he's like, I heard another theory that it could be water that they're scared of. Yeah. And they're like, oh, that's stupid, too.
Yeah.
So literally both of the both times they hear like what's actually happening, the water and then it being aliens, they say stupid.
Shyamalan's reasoning for going to water is also very stupid. Like, so I'm with the kids on this one. Shyamalan's just like, I've looked at the crop circle or the crop signs, and they aren't near any water, so I think they might not like water. Yeah, I'm just that's a stupid reason, but whatever. So
it's like, how has no one else figured this out?
Yeah, I'm just like, you do you, man. Whatever, go to the water.
Or like, how did you choose Earth? How did you see, as an alien, see Earth from the outside, which is mostly water?
Yes,
they'd be like, we hate water, but we're coming there.
We hate water, but this planet has what we need.
There is quite a bit of land too.
There is,
but if you're seeing it as an alien, you're seeing mostly like that's a water planet.
Okay.
Like, dude, go to Mars or something if you're fucking looking for dirt. Like,
no, there's no...
Wait, no.
I thought humans, though.
One of your favorite parts of Transformers 2 is them calling Earth dirt, you know?
I mean, that's what it literally means, though. Okay.
Okay,
Let's not bring up Transformers again.
But yeah, this is where they have to vote.
Yeah, the vote.
You know,
this is also a really funny moment. Like this is another thing that makes him kind of like he's going genre with it because he's not going too serious. He knows where to be cheesy to be. Like, I think he puts the cheese in great moments in this movie.
Yes,
because there's a lot of tension going on in the movie, and this is not the type of movie where he wants you to just have tension the entire way through. He wants to have little moments of levity also.
Yes.
And I think it's more because
just by the nature of the story, there's always tension. It's happening the whole time for the most
part. Well, and
like, it's over the course of a night.
Yes, and whenever you're tense, like they are, things can just seem kind of funny like this. Like, they don't think this is funny in the movie. Like, him raising his vote to 2 is not seen as funny. Although, to me, I laughed so hard whenever he's like, my vote's 2.
Just to get his way.
Get his way, literally. Because they're trying to vote to either stay at the house or go to the lake where Ray is, basically, stay near the waters, because that might...
It's just another theory.
Like, and the reason they stay is because the kids don't want to leave where they live with their mom, which is a sweet thing.
Yeah,
and it just plays another part where they can't let go of the past.
But yeah, that's why they end up staying at the house.
Yeah,
and so another coincidence, or is it a sign? You know, that's kind of the whole point.
Yep, and then they start boarding up the house after this because they know this is like the field they had around them hiding themselves has disappeared. The ships have appeared over more parts of the world now. There are more parts of the world. They're all getting ready, these like attack patterns or something. And then I think this is whenever Morgan comes in and says, I was wrong. They're hostile.
Yep.
And so Meryl and Mel get... I can't remember his name. What is his name in the movie?
Meryl and... What's Mel Gibson's name?
Yeah, what's Mel Gibson's name? I keep on calling him Mel. Meryl and Mel. Graham. Okay. Meryl and Graham start boarding up the house because they expect an attack after this. And they're right. Yes.
They start boarding up the house. Yep. And then the next major scene is when they cook the meals for everyone. Because the Joaquin Phoenix says, let's... cook something fast, and they all say, and then Mel Gibson kind of just admitting like this might be their last meal.
It's seen as their last supper.
Yes, last supper basically. It's like let's cook our favorite things.
Yeah,
but this is why I love this moment. Is after they have all the food done, they're all sitting there. None of them want to eat.
Well, no, they're waiting for the prayer.
They're waiting for prayer, but I saw more as just like they know this is the end, so they don't want to finish it. It's like. They know once they eat this, it's over, kind of thing. They've all admitted that to themselves, so they're just holding off, you know. And that's why he wants to say a prayer. You know, it's almost just like basically this unknown kind of that. Like basically, you have to say a prayer in that moment, right? Because there's nothing else you can do. But that's what Mel Gibson's been fighting this whole movie.
Yeah,
you know, there's got to be some other logical reason, or like we're just gonna enjoy that. He's like basically yelling at them for not being more logical about it. You know, that's kind of what it feels like to me anyway.
Oh, he is. Yeah.
He's like, you know, we're not praying anymore, and you can tell like all that pent up, you know, rage he has.
It's let loose in this scene for sure. Yep. It's one of the best acting scenes of the movie for sure because. Oh, honestly, everyone's acting in this scene is amazing because the kids, you believe them, they just start crying, and I mean. like everyone just starts crying. it's just a sweet scene.
And that's what I was saying, though.
It's depressing, but it ends up being sweet.
Oh, yes.
Because, like, it's the breaking point for Mel Gibson's character in this movie where he has to start believing the signs, basically, or else they're not going to live, literally.
But that's what I was saying. This scene even works, though, if there was no event. If there was so just,
it's just a family.
His wife had died,
yeah.
And they're like, we're going to have a happy meal together. And then Mel Gibson, their son.
Yes, because this is not. This scene to me is not about the aliens. It's about them all. Yes. It's definitely about the mom.
No, the son says, I hate you, you know. Yeah. I think he says something about the mom, too. I forget
what he said. Well, and whenever Mel Gibson's going crazy, also, like, Meryl is literally saying, they're telling, like, calm down, dude. Like he's saying there, like, he's kind of shocked that he's this the vitriol coming out of his mouth. He's kind of shocked about it.
Yeah.
Like, he knew it was under there, but he didn't think it would come out in this moment, basically.
No. And then right after they hug and everything, Hillary says, it's happening.
Yeah, because, well, they know it's happening because they have the news station on, and then the news station goes out. And that's,
no, it's the baby monitor. It starts going off right
when they're hugging. The baby monitor.
And then they say it's happening.
Yeah, but also, the news station does cut out. That's how they actually know it's happening, because they cut the broadcast doesn't cut. What's assumed is the aliens, like, knocked out the radio towers or whatever, so you can't, they can't see it anymore.
But yeah, this leads to all of, like, the.
This leads to whenever.
They go in the basement.
But even before that, it's just even more tension building. If you don't see the alien at all, you just hear the clicking and clacking outside, and then you just hear the breaking window upstairs. And
well,
then,
you forget the first thing they hear is the dog dying.
Yeah.
Whimpering.
Yeah. You know? Because it's such a sad scene.
They say they forget to get it.
Yeah, because Morgan's like, we forgot Isabel.
Yeah, and then they hear it whimpering.
And they just hear it die. Yeah.
They hear it whimpering, and then also there's another little moment I love. It's kind of going with this theme of they're starting to accept what's happening to them.
Yeah.
Is Joaquin Phoenix says, should we turn off the lights? And Mel Gibson says, they already know we're here. Yeah. What's the point? Yeah. You know, like why would we just, almost this whole movie is just, we're just doing stuff just to say we're doing it, you know, to give us comfort when we should just accept what's happening in front of us, you know? And this kind of just leads to that. But yeah, so then that's when they go to the basement.
Yeah, because the attic, they forgot the attic. It's the only way they can get in. And this is another great shot because they're running towards the basement, and you see just the hand as he's pulling back on probably a dolly. Like you just see that hand reaching under the door,
The
alien hand. And Morgan's the one that sees it because this is the first time he's seen the alien in real life. And he's the one that gets captured, obviously, later on. But yeah, they run to the basement. They end up locking it, or like getting themselves locked in there. They finally find the pickaxe. Marilyn's stupidity knocks out the light so they can't see anything. Stupidity.
Swing away,
Marilyn.
It can't help
So this is the moment where Morgan says, they actually just figure out they're hitting the door. They're just making noises to keep them distracted because. Yes. They're apparently problems. I don't know how they figure out the problem solvers, but I mean, sure.
That's what he says. Dr. Boo Boo says it as well. It sounds dumb, but that's literally what
happens. It sounds dumb, but yeah, that's literally what happens. They find Marilyn Graham. Graham realizes or remembers that this used to be like a place where they could like filter coal into, and they have a mine shaft somewhere in there. And so they're looking around for it, and then somehow Morgan gets where it is. I don't understand how that happens because I never know where. I don't know where he is in this entire room, in this whole room. Honestly, whenever Meryl knocks out the light, we get thrown. Like we don't know what's happening.
The logic of the room
kind of goes
it's
away.
It's like implied it's a circle.
Yeah, it's implied it's a circle. Morgan's just back there, right where it is. And you don't see anything at first, and then the hand just moves and grabs him.
And the way it moves, you see it for a second, but most of the scene takes place with just a shot on the flashlight on the ground, and you hear the noises of them trying to grab him away.
It's another great choice.
It's a really great choice. And then you see the flashlight move a little bit, and it shows the girl hiding in the corner. Just like, see, this is where he's so good at just like being a good filmmaker, you know, getting good images and making it feel tense.
Yeah, and especially whenever I'm not sure the budget on Signs, but the alien doesn't look great coming up. It doesn't look amazing. Like, it doesn't hold up, you know? Which
it was much better when we
briefly saw
him, you know?
Exactly. Like, that's why he held off on showing it until he had to. And that is honestly good. Because at least the first time we see it on the video camera, it makes sense for it to look that bad because it's a shitty video camera.
Yeah, definitely.
This is how we know this is a different America than this when this movie came out. This was a $72 million budget, which is higher than I thought.
That is higher than I thought.
But it looks amazing. And,
it does look great. Yeah.
But it made $60 million opening weekend, and it grossed worldwide $408 million.
Damn.
This would be like a streaming movie if it came out now.
It would be, dude.
Yeah, one location.
Yeah, honestly. $400 million. That's kind of crazy. This is why like Shyamalan was considered like the next big thing, you know, or like a lot of people called him the early Spielberg.
Hasn't he been a box office success most of his career anyway?
Most of it's just those middle movies where it's like Last Airbender, After Earth was a huge bomb, I think.
Lady in the Water.
But yeah. I don't know. Right before the climax of the movie. That's so impressive. $408 million worldwide.
That is extremely impressive, dude.
No, I'm impressed.
Because this scene is what causes, or the scene of all this happening is what causes Morgan to go into asthma.
He starts
having his asthma attack. Yeah. That actually happened maybe a little bit before this too. But yeah, they end up running out of the basement eventually. They stop hearing everything because what's implied is the humans won. Like, they figured out a way. Like, the news broadcast is back on everything, I think.
Yeah, so it's, like, basically this whole scene of, like, remember the asthma attack's happening.
Yes. They're trying to find, because the medicine's upstairs. That's the whole reason they have to go back up there.
So, yeah, the asthma attack. But I just want to mention the asthma attack, because it's basically Mel Gibson basically telling the audience, like, this whole, what I've been saying, the whole theme is of... Basically, because he says he thinks his son is dying.
Yeah.
So he like literally says, "I hate you." Literally, like he's talking to God, obviously.
Yeah.
And he says, "I hate you," and then he says, "The fear is feeding it," and then he says, "Don't be afraid of what's happening. Believe, just believe." And that's kind of this whole point of the movie. It's like, you know, you have to believe first before you can see signs.
Yep.
And that's when the whole movie shifts. You can kind of, and that's where the aliens leave too. And it's he's trying to draw that connection of once he gets over that fear, the aliens are gone. Yeah. You know, that's literally when it happens back to back. But yeah, because it's a great shot of Joaquin Phoenix when he walks out. There's like the kind of like, you know, little kids have on their windows, like stars.
Yeah.
So when the sunlight comes through the stars, it'll look like... It's just a really good shot of Joaquin Phoenix walking up the stairs and you see like a moon and stars like shining down on him.
Yeah.
It's just a really great shot. But yeah, and this is where they find out the news is saying the aliens have just got up and left.
Yeah, the aliens got up and left. They don't really know the reason why yet. And they turn the TV off. Something turns the TV up. And you just see... This is like... Oh, such a great shot.
It is.
Because this is something that we... I mean, you can still get that with modern TVs, I guess. But the tube TVs just make it work much better. Because like you just see the alien in the background, Morgan. In his arms. And... like he had somehow gotten in there.
You said like the alien doesn't look great. And I kind of agree.
Well, and so it only doesn't look great whenever he hangs on it.
And that's whenever, what I'm saying. That's why I think if there was some way he could have found out a way to just film the alien only through the TVs or something.
Oh, that would have been awesome.
You know, that would have been really cool. But I can see why like he just wants people to have the satisfaction of seeing the alien.
Once Meryl starts swinging away, like you can't really do all that through the tube TV. Be a little too. Although the way he filmed it,
it's really honestly scarier when they see it through the reflection. That's what I'm saying.
It's so creepy, dude. Because he's just standing there.
Because that's how Gibson sees it for the first time.
It is. Well, the full thing, yes.
Yeah, because he kind of drops a TV or something.
TV like falls. Yeah, or something happens with the TV. It like falls over or something, and then he sees in the reflection. And then
he's having his like it's amazing shot, super close up on his face, like a fisheye lens, and then it cuts back to this flashback of the words that end up being a sign. You know, because earlier in the movie he has said, "Do you know why she said those words? It was just a random."
Her brainstem randomly
those were the last random thoughts she had.
Yeah.
But those random thoughts she had ended up being the sign. Yeah. And that all changed based on how he saw it.
Yeah. It was a thing she said at the Meryl's baseball game, basically.
First, she says Graham C.
Yeah.
And that's supposed to basically say in the movie sense of him looking to see the baseball bat right next to him.
Okay.
And then say, swing away, Meryl. Uh-huh. And that's what makes him grab the bat.
Yeah, I wasn't a huge fan of this ending, but it's kind of making
more sense. I like the idea.
It's making more sense now.
I really like the idea, even if I don't like at least one half of it.
No, the only thing I don't like about this movie is the water thing. That's literally the only thing I don't like about this movie, honestly.
I think maybe that part is just... maybe it's just because of the girl. You know, she has that.
Well, tick. It's not even that. It's just the fact that these aliens can get here, but they are so stupid that they came to a warp. Yes, yes, yes. Like, it's just so stupid.
Maybe they are arrogant. You
know? Maybe they are arrogant. I mean, hey, that could be implied, honestly, for, like, even this alien staying behind, thinking that he could at least take this person with him.
Because
the thing is, this is the alien that Mel Gibson cut the fingers off of, so this is at least considered revenge. Or at least that's what this thing is. Maybe.
Which is why would they be here, but, like, it could be that aspect, too. These aliens are not that smart. That's why they leave, like...
Well, this is the alien that he did cut the fingers off of.
Yes, it is. Like, this one came back. But the news broadcast says some of the aliens are still left behind.
Mm-hmm.
Like, right when they see their alien, too. So it's kind of implied.
And,
like,
and it should be implied, because this alien was locked in the pantry.
Yes,
so,
yes.
So it probably took him a sec to get out.
Yeah. Probably didn't receive the orders yet. You
know? Probably not. But yes, we finally get the
swinging, and then the asthma attack, which I mentioned earlier.
Yeah, the asthma. Well, yeah, we get the poison, because right after Meryl goes to grab the bat or something, that's whenever it sprays it with poison, because it knows, like, it's about to get attacked.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's going to at least try to take someone with
it.
Yeah, yeah. And then I honestly love it whenever Meryl's swinging away, because he does some really great shots of, like, especially the one where Meryl's just, like, getting ready to swing. He swings and knocks the thing over, and then the camera just falls along with it.
I know the shot
water pours, like, right on top of it. It's a really great...
great
he has some really great things in this. Like, the only scene... Like, I don't like how the alien looks, especially whenever the water's pouring on it.
Yeah.
And you can just see, like, this really bad CGI and stuff like that. That's why I really like how he, like... doesn't go back to that very often.
No, that's the only
thing. He doesn't show the alien
the
too
shot
much.
The shot from the alien's perspective of the water coming on it.
Yes.
That's a great shot.
It is. It's an amazing shot.
Basically, just all the shots with the actual alien being seen are the ones that aren't the greatest.
They don't hold up as much.
Yeah, they don't hold up as much. It almost feels like you could do without them, basically, honestly, for the most part, I would feel like.
Yeah. But then after this is whenever we're outside. And Mel Gibson is saying... It's like the asthma attacks, or it's like his lungs were closed, the poison didn't get it, his lungs were closed. He just keeps on repeating that, because he has to believe at this point, you know?
Yep.
And then I think he's like, don't take my son away from me too, basically.
Yeah. And the son wakes up.
And then he wakes up, because it's so good, because you just see Mel Gibson's face, and then you just hear what happens. Like, and you don't know who's speaking, technically. I mean, I don't, because his voice sounds... very high also, so it could easily be the girl to me, but then it just pans over, because at this point Meryl and the daughter are both crying. They already think he's dead, like, especially Meryl. Meryl's like over there literally in tears.
No, because when he wakes up, the son says, did someone save me?
Mm-hmm.
And then he says, I think someone did.
Yeah.
And that's when the movie ends, and the camera pans across, and then we see it's winter. And then Mel Gibson walks out, and he's dressed as a priest.
Yep.
And it just ends there. Like, just like it begins, it ends with the event, you know?
Yep.
It, like, doesn't go too far, which I love, too.
You know what? I'm going to raise it to 4 stars.
Let's go! Change his opinion mid-podcast. I love it.
Yeah. Just to put that on record. I gave
just
it... I don't do half stars, but I gave
honestly,
it 3 stars.
Honestly, if you hadn't said that, if people had gone and looked after, they would have just seen 4 stars.
Now
everyone knows that you gave it 3 initially.
I was transparent. I wasn't huge on the ending and stuff like that. But,
No, I still agree. Like, I could see why it would take people out of it a little bit. But,
But like, you putting it in that context, it makes a lot more sense.
The way it ties together.
Yeah, the way it ties together with everything. But,
Yeah, that's Signs. I mean, we went an hour just on that one, so...
Yeah, I mean,
we were
Signs
like,
I don't
know if we're
really
going to go
down
the whole episode.
I mean,
it's
Signs
a great
is really
movie,
good.
I really liked it.
It's definitely my favorite Shyamalan movie. I'll go ahead and say that right now.
I think it might be.
I need to rewatch Sixth Sense again. That's the only one I haven't seen recently. And I need to watch The Visit, because people love The Visit. Haven't seen that one yet. But as of now, Signs is easily his best one. Maybe not easily, because Unbreakable is very... good
yeah,
too.
That's true.
But
I need to rewatch.
Yeah, I need to rewatch Unbreakable as well. Like, those two movies are amazing, and Sixth Sense is really good too, from what I remember.
Sixth Sense,
and I mean, he does have a movie coming out next year, so we might have to come back to him.
Oh, that's true.
Is it announced what's about?
It's, on Letterboxd, it says "Untitled M. Night Shyamalan Project 2024."
Okay, okay.
So,
you love to see it.
Yeah, he's a true craft filmmaker too.
He's not
yeah.
Yeah,
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 exactly.
Yeah,
you know, he's making these, like, we should honestly a good transition to the next movie, another one location movie.
Yep.
Jumping right in, you know, just a lot of the tension being created just by the way he's using the camera, the way that
this first conversation is like
so
yeah, it's really good. Filmed.
And I love
the
it
way
because...
the way he like super like zooms in on their faces, keeps
yeah.
you know, I think he does it like gradually too. And until it's like, you notice it, and he keeps going back and forth about it.
Yeah, because it starts out like a wide shot, and what I really like in this opening scene, at least, is how we always say we like directors filming from the child's point of view, or filming from their eye level.
Yeah.
He does that in this scene. Like, he's filming it from her eye level, not Dave Bautista's, obviously.
Yes.
Because we start out, he zooms into her very closely, like you said, it's just, she's trying to catch beetle...
Grasshoppers.
Yeah, I know. I knew it was some type of insect that she was trying to catch. Yeah, because
not only from her perspective, but just like from the opening scene, it's seen why he cast Dave Bautista.
Yes,
because we get both sides of him. The just if you saw this huge fucking guy walking towards you, and it's this little girl and there's no parents around her, you would be scared as fuck, you know, obviously, if you were watching this. But like, he also has this really niceness about him. That is, you know, in the context of the movie, it's a horror movie, so you feel it feels creepy, but at the same time, he's just, he's very naturally such a nice person.
And then you learn, later you learn know. That he's a elementary school teacher, and like, works with kids. So, now it makes sense in context.
Even though it's still tense in the movie, but like, exactly. It makes more sense why he's so naturally good at talking.
And why he's the one of the group that goes to talk to
him. Yes. No, that's true. That's true. But yeah, so then... she goes inside, like runs in, closes the
door. Well, and this scene, specifically the scene where they're talking to each other, is interesting because she's saying she's very good at catching grasshoppers, and he says he's also very good at catching grasshoppers, and that's whenever they get stuck in the house. So, like, it's basically, at least to me, it's him trying to say, like, all right,
Also, her favorite movie is Kiki's Delivery Service.
Yes.
Okay,
shout out.
Kiki's Delivery Service. That's a hint to next week. We're doing Ghibli again.
So we
know Shyamalan's a Ghibli fan, at least.
Yes.
Kiki's Delivery Service is an amazing movie.
It's a great movie.
Fire movie.
What if the girl actually just, like Shyamalan did, like, he just said, say whatever your favorite movie is, I'm not going to tell you what to say, and she said that, that'd be awesome.
That'd be fire.
She'd have a fan for life for me, so.
I'll be watching your career closely.
I'll be watching your career closely.
This is kind of related to that, but all three of the child performances in both of these movies are great.
They are, yes. Yeah. We should have said that. He's a great director of child.
I mean, you just watched Sixth Sense recently.
Yeah, definitely very difficult to do.
And Osment's, like, you know, famous for that role, but... Yeah, he's really good at making kids feel like they are experiencing the terror the same way the humans, I mean the adults are.
He puts them on the same level.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. He treats them as humans, you know.
Kind of like Miyazaki.
Exactly.
With Kiki's Delivery Service, maybe that's a tie. I don't know.
She runs away, obviously.
She runs inside the house, and this is where we meet the two husbands.
Yeah.
And this is kind of where the movie starts.
Yeah, this scene is tense, too. Like, the knocking and stuff.
No, this scene reminded, and it was in the trailer, too, this scene reminded me of Us.
For sure.
When the family's trying to get into Us, into the house in Us, too.
Yeah.
Oh, man, that scene is so scary. Okay, yeah, sorry. I was...
Both of them are scary. The reason why this one feels almost a little more realistic, at least, is because it's in daylight.
Yeah, okay.
You know, it just feels like even more scary for that reason, where it's like supposed to just be. I just thought the
silhouette of the family with the little boy scattering when they clap and both of them scatter. That's the scariest thing out of all of that.
No, because they look like a normal family at first, and then it's like they're like superhero doing superhero shit when they start sprinting around like that.
We already had an episode on.
Yeah, we did Us too. Yeah, but yeah, so then. They basically get in eventually. I forget, like, they do put up a fight.
This is another part of the movie where the dads don't fully believe her at the very beginning. They do believe her very quickly because
they're yelling at, like, they're having a conversation.
Yeah, they're having a conversation. She just runs in as a very freaked out that there are people coming, obviously. But then, they're at they end up knocking on the door and say, we can do this the easy way or the hard way, basically. Like, you can let us in, we can talk about this like normal people, or we'll have to break in. Literally.
They think it's like Jehovah's Witnesses people.
Yeah, that's what they think it is, Jehovah's Witnesses.
And then they look out the windows like, oh my gosh, that guy has like an axe or whatever.
They have these makeshift weapons, which are really cool, honestly.
Yeah, they are.
Like, they literally look like normal housework, like rakes and stuff like that, but just with like things welded onto them, like to make them way more deadly and stuff.
But it makes sense in terms of the story of these are just normal people
that
have had intense visions that they can't help.
Yeah.
You know, and that's why they're like towing these lines. They're in between these two worlds of fantasy and reality, you know. Yeah. And that's why they're using these everyday items and everything. Yep. But yeah, so they get to the... And that's kind of what I love about the movie in general, and it kind of relates to science of... This movie would work even if the alien attack didn't happen at the end. you know, just was
or
this.
Or if Armageddon
didn't happen. Or if Armageddon didn't happen. Yeah, not, yeah. The end of the world didn't happen again. Because it would just be like some conspiracy theory nuts having the same vision on a forum. Like the way they're explaining in the movie what actually would happen, right? Yes. It's like, oh, they just recorded the news events. They put it, this is all recorded tape and all the explanations they give.
Yeah.
The movie would still work if that was the truth.
Yeah, because
it feels like the characters are in their own world anyway.
Yes.
You know?
And with the amount of forums nowadays and how gullible some people, especially in America, are, you could easily see people being convinced about this by someone that hates gay people to go do this to gay people.
Yes.
Like, that's one of the things they think about.
And that's what they think about.
That's
right?
what he thinks about.
Oh, this guy hates gay people for what happened in the past. And so he's going to create some kind of story and get other people to believe it, but his real reason is something different.
Yes.
And that could happen, right? Like, where someone's
real motivations
are to hate gay people, but the people that get involved in the group, they actually believe it's because the world is ending and they're just trying to do the right thing.
Cults have two different types of people. The people that know their cults and the people that don't know their cults. So.
But that's the thing. Like, it's almost like he's trying to draw the line just with the religion in general, too. Even though you could say religion is a cult in a way in terms of how people approach it a lot of times. But that's a really good point about it. It's kind of just like, it does seem like they're just in a cult or something crazy like that.
Yes, because it's very hard for these people, obviously, to buy in. Because they break in. It takes them a sec to break in. The home invasion thing takes like 10 minutes. And what happens is one of the dads actually gets a serious injury, severe concussion, during the fight. And this is where things start to get very weird. Because at first you just... it's an M.I. Shyamalan movie. And David Bautista's already been kind of nice, which is already kind of weird.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But the girl literally knocks him over. He has a severe concussion. She's like so worried about him right after that. She like goes down and like starts taking care of him.
And she's a nurse and everything.
Yeah, and then the other guy... And then the husband comes and like gets her off of him. Because he thinks he's trying to do something else, obviously.
Yeah.
But then they eventually both get captured, tied down in the chair... they start trying to explain to them like who they are, basically. Mm-hmm. Like this is where
their introduction are kind of they go like one by one.
They do.
Yeah.
Which is funny because
this is how
like,
a lot of the movie takes place too. Just them tied up and a lot of conversations about what's going on.
Yeah, yeah. It's a very I don't want to say like info dump, but it's kind of just what it is.
It is.
It's one reason why the movie can feel boring to me.
Yes.
And why he doesn't keep this... Like, Signs is the perfect movie because it keeps that tension the whole way through, like we said.
Yeah.
It has moments of levity, which I love. But this movie, it has long portions where there's just talking.
Yes.
Yeah,
and it's kind of boring.
Yes.
Unless you're... I thought I was fully bought in, and I was still getting a little bored sometimes, so...
No, it's like...
There wasn't a lot to grab onto, I feel like, a lot of points, but...
Maybe it's like
there
there's like
cool
one. There should
things.
Have been three people, not four. Maybe because each of them have.
There are cool things that happen. Like there are like the first guy dying being the homophobe actually did this to them.
And they only realize after he dies.
Yes, they only realize after they die. They actually only realize whenever they actually he gets out, because whenever both the husbands escape and actually kill.
No, it's only Dave Bautista yet. And
yeah, it's
they
only
hold
Dave
him
Bautista.
By gunpoint, he finally gets to. Cause
he finally
he
tried
gets
to
do
to
it
find
before.
It. Yeah,
but...
he tried to do it before, they wouldn't let him. Because the whole sneaking suspicion of one of the husbands, I think it's the guy on White Collar, I can't remember his name.
The non concussed guy.
The who?
Wait,
I'll look up the cast.
Yeah, look up the cast.
Were you talking about the character that's
Ben Aldridge is Andrew and Jonathan Groff is Eric?
I think it's Ben Aldridge.
Jonathan Groff is the concussed guy that is the one that's kind of believing everything.
Okay, yes.
On.
Yes, yes, yes.
Yeah.
And Ben Aldridge is the other guy you were talking about.
Yes.
The
non-concussed guy.
Yes.
That's
kind of how
I can think about
okay,
it.
Okay, that's good. But
the non-concussed guy.
But what were you saying about the non-concussed guy?
I don't remember what I was saying about him honestly anymore. But
anyway, okay, we were kind of going in order. We were at the Redman had just died, the first guy.
Well, we missed a huge part. It's like right whenever Redman dies, this is another thing that plays in very well with Signs. Honestly, is that the husband that has the severe concussion thinks he sees a sign.
Yeah,
it's a phenomenal shot because you just see a ray of light shining off a mirror. Literally highlighting, I'm pretty sure it's the guy that plays Roy or Ron Weasley in Harry Potter.
Yeah,
but
it is.
Yeah, it is. Okay.
Well, no, there's actually I've seen people taking photos in the theater. There's actually a figure that gets...
Oh, there actually is a figure. Yeah, because I didn't see the figure. I just saw the ray of light, and I was like, you could easily take this as this guy just had a severe concussion.
Yeah, you
could. And that's what they say later on.
That's how the other characters explain it.
Yes,
that's how they rationalize it.
Yeah, that's how they're trying to rationalize it. Yeah. But he, deep down, fully believes it. And honestly, one of the... Like, his face in that scene... You see, he believes it right then. Honestly, to me at least, like
it's literally from that moment. Yeah. Really, it's like deep down he knows that these people like, and he's already kind of been able to tell because this is after he's been treated by her, right? Yeah. And she's telling her story, and you can tell like by the way she's panicking, like the way she's taking care of him and everything. Like this is someone who's just a normal person and is having these visions like they can't control.
Yeah,
you know, and like of course his husband. Basically, he cannot believe in a world where that's true.
Yes.
Right?
He's the Mel Gibson character.
Yes, yes, he is.
Yeah.
But his view also, and this is why at least the ideas in this movie are really good, because his perspective also makes sense.
Yes.
Of course, they would attack the one gay couple
here.
You know, and of course, they would try to find some other reason. Well, it's actually the end of the world, and they're going to, of course, it's the gay couple that has to make the sacrifice to do it.
Yeah.
You know? So you can see his perspective as well. And that's what makes the movie so intense, where it's like, there really is no right answer.
Yeah.
You know, and I listened to the interview that Shyamalan did on the Ringer, one of the Ringer podcasts, and he talks about how basically the reason why he wanted to make this movie was this whole idea of making the choice. That was like really important to him, where he wanted the humans to have to make the choice at the end, and that's what makes this whole movie kind of at least on the idea level really hold through the whole time.
The idea definitely holds through. I like the idea
because
a lot.
You could see at the end where this whole thing, and then maybe they both survive or something. They both escape. The gunman, you know, he gets the gun from the car, and they all win. You know,
yeah.
And you know, maybe only one of them is really badly hurt or something.
Or the twist would be it's not real, obviously.
Yeah, it's not real, but they still both get out.
Yeah,
you know, but the fact that I mean, I'm just gonna spoil it anyway because we're
gonna spoil it.
Yeah, I've already mentioned the ending anyway. I think, but anyway, the fact that. He does, the guy that sees the sign, he is the one that ends up sacrificing his life.
Yeah.
Maybe because of that moment, maybe because of, it's kind of implied.
Yes. And it's a very heartfelt moment, especially because the whole movie, especially in the flashbacks, you're seeing them saying it's only us two, basically. I think they have, their quote literally is, I can't remember exactly. It's just like, it'll be me and you. Forever and always, or something like that. Yeah. Me and you forever, or something.
And I love, like, in this moment, I'm pretty sure it's somewhere around this, having an emotional moment when he cuts to a flash forward of one of them.
Their daughter.
With their daughter.
Yeah.
Yes.
Which honestly, it got to me.
That scene got to me.
I kind of like the ending, honestly.
Oh, the ending's honestly great.
I know you still kind of disagree. Didn't you just... I remember you said you didn't really like it when we came out of the theater, but...
I didn't like the whole, like, when they're driving out and... Driving off and everything. But I mean, it's okay. It's not my favorite. It's like
no, the flash forward.
I do like the flash forward.
It's such a heartfelt moment because he's like, I saw you and our daughter.
And also, but it makes so much sense because that's his vision.
Yes,
you know, just like the fact that he was the first one to believe their visions.
Yeah,
this is his first vision where he knows this has to happen.
Yes,
and I also really liked how it's like couple like to think about like how they mentioned that like. So many different couples through time have made
decisions.
I thought that was super interesting to think about.
Yeah,
we are kind of jumping ahead.
No, we are jumping ahead. We should say the four people that come, obviously the four horsemen of the apocalypse.
Yeah. I did not expect that. I wasn't thinking about it in that way probably, so I probably should have known, but like it kind of did catch me by surprise.
Yeah, no, those four horsemen of the apocalypse, each time one of them dies, a part of humanity is being judged.
Yep.
So the first person that dies is
Redman.
Redman. That's his name.
Rupert
what?
The actor's name.
Ron Weasley.
His name's Redman in the movie.
Feel bad for calling him Ron Weasley though, because like if I was an actor, I'd be so.
Yeah, that would.
He's actually he's pretty good in this movie, honestly.
Yeah, he's definitely good.
Because he's the one that we find out being he's the gay homophobe. The gay homophobe. The homophobe.
He's the homophobe. Because he's the. Because we find out because he's the horseman that represents what is it
malice
and that's the reason why he was set there
whenever they kill him I don't remember the thing that
tsunami
happens.
Is it tsunami
I don't the tsunami happened the next time or was that this one
I'd have to watch it again to know
I would have to watch it again
but
tsunami scene
no the tsunami cool. it is he is the tsunami one Because the next one is the girl with the son that dies, and hers is the avian flu or something. Or there's some type of disease was attacking children. Because her big reveal is she has a kid, and that's how she's trying.
Or they don't believe her, though.
They don't. He doesn't believe her. The husband doesn't believe her. And then that's another thing that's revealed later. That he finds the backpack she does.
She does have a kid.
She wasn't lying. Just another thing.
Damn, that's another little good moment.
Yeah, it is. And that's it's not that.
No, but what makes this scene so cool, at least with the first death, and that's maybe where it kind of overplays the doing it over and over again with four people. But the first time it happens, when Redmond just accepts that it's happening, he goes and kneels in front of it, and it just it happens. You know, there's he's scared. Like there's a like you, and then you in that moment you start to realize why he's so tense about everything, why he's so defensive.
Yeah,
why when they're like. We're all introducing.
He's literally dying.
Yes, because he knows he's the first one too. Yeah. Like, because remember, they're like, it'll maybe be easier if we all introduce ourselves and seem like normal people, and then all telling them their backstory.
Yeah.
And Redmond's the one who's like, this shit's not gonna work. You know, they don't care about us. Like, they're not gonna do. They're not gonna make the choice. And you're like, we're like, and he seems crazy. Obviously, he's supposed to be the crazy one.
Yeah.
But then when we learn he's the first to die, all of it clicks, and you're like, okay, this is why he didn't want to do all this because he knew it wasn't gonna work.
Yeah.
And
also, I also remember another one of the disasters that happened: the planes falling.
Yeah, that was the third one.
The
third one.
Yes,
because it starts.
The CG is not the best, but I like the idea of it.
I thought it looked pretty.
It's creepy. Honestly. It's creepy.
It's good. Yeah.
All the planes just start falling.
Yeah. Don't you see them when they step out too? Like at the end, you see the planes falling too. Yeah, like that was cool.
Yeah, you see one in real life.
Because one of the best... one of the best things about that first death scene is the reactions from everyone else after they kill him. Like, Dave Bautista literally goes and throws up. Everyone else is like...
Yes, exactly.
Like, that's just another scene where these are just normal ass
people. Yeah, they're not...
People.
They can't...
Normal people that had to kill a dude. Like...
Yeah.
Like, they probably... Like, an elementary teacher, a mom, and a nurse had to kill someone. Like...
like, they saw a vision so intense about the world ending that they literally had to commit a real death even though they didn't want to.
They had to commit a real murder.
Even though they didn't want to.
They had to give up their own life, too.
And that's what makes the... gives it even more weight too, right? If they were just killing other people, then you would be like, "Oh, there's no way it's real, right?" But the fact that they're willing to kill themselves,
one of the first reveals that happens is like they're scared that something's gonna happen to them, and they're like, "If you guys don't do this, we're gonna kill ourselves." And I was like. A funny part in the movie. It kind of is because like the people sitting in the chair are like, "Oh God, they're gonna kill us or something," and they're like, "Oh, you're gonna kill yourselves? Okay,
yes, exactly."
Like to them, they're just like, "Okay." I would have been like, "Okay, kill yourselves, please. Let me out here."
That's kind of what happens.
That's kind of what happens. Yeah,
they all kill them. They all die, and then they get out.
That's how they're able to get out easier. Yeah. After the first death, then we just keep on going on. They turn on the news channel. Shyamalan cameo comes in.
Yes,
he's doing like a cooking ad or something. Yeah. It's one of those like late night ad shows that are always on.
It's funny, cable and shit. They're selling cooking.
Oh yeah, supplies. It's really funny, and then it just cuts to the breaking news eventually. The breaking news was that there was just an earthquake off the coast.
Mega tsunami, I guess.
Going to be a tsunami, but actually, at first, he gives you that little, like, is it actually real or not?
Yeah, because they're like, it wasn't that big. And you could see, maybe in that moment, imagine the people that have done the kidnapping. They're like, really, that's it? Because I think even one of them says, like, really, that's it?
Yeah.
Like, we just did all this for that?
Yeah.
We just killed Redmond for that, basically? And then... and then they're like, no, this is actually really...
Yeah, because this is also when, I think, the dad that's not wanting to believe any of this, he is yelling at them saying, you guys are obviously a part of like this online forum that is started by people that just hate gay people and they got you to believe this or something. If I can prove you, if you just let me see. Because I think this might be the first time where he thinks the guy that they killed is the one that...
he realizes.
That attacked him in the bar.
Yeah, he realized
that. Because he's like, I can promise you that if you check his ID, it won't be whatever.
And they don't want to check.
And they don't want to check. Yes. Yeah.
Because they're also scared, deep down, what if this is not true?
Yeah. And then right after he says that, I'm pretty sure the next earthquake happens, yeah, and or the aftershock and happens. And that's whenever, confirmed, yeah. That's whenever they see. I honestly love Shyamalan and how he takes, like, he does the just like point of view videos of, like, yeah, both, yeah, the movies, like where you see the alien for the first time, and mm-hmm, this time he's just doing the point of view of just like the, you could just see the water, yeah, pulling out, and then just that wave, the huge wave, yeah, of water coming, and you can, yeah, see the girl. The girl's like, those are the rocks in my vision and stuff. So it's just starting to confirm it even more for them.
Damn. And have any of the flashbacks happened at this point? Because those kind of happen throughout.
I think they happen throughout. This one,
it might be, if you're saying the scene where the lawyer,
yeah,
if he when he says he remembers Redmond, it's shortly after where that
flashback shortly happens. Afterward, yes, because at least the thing is, he says the Redmond thing whenever all three of the other people are still alive. So it happens very soon. Like, the flashback with him getting attacked happens very soon. But there's also another flashback before.
Yeah, it initially, and the initial one was, like, really quickly. It only showed the smash,
yes,
for a second.
But the original one before actually might have even been, like, I think the first flashback they have is whenever
they're
sitting there with their parents, and that's whenever the first line of, like, it'll be me and you forever, basically, or something.
Yeah, it was, like super, because they drove, like, 7 hours, and they're only here, like, for, like, 30 minutes or something.
And that's coming from the South, that's very common.
Yeah.
Like, it's, yeah.
To drive that much.
Yeah. Well, not to drive that much, but just to be still that prejudiced.
Your son
can be like that, and you can drive that long, and then just leave after 50 minutes. That, yeah. Like, just because you're uncomfortable.
No, that is a sad scene.
It's, yeah, because, like, I mean, I know people that have dealt with stuff like that, you know,
yeah,
like.
Yeah, especially in the South.
Yeah.
But yeah, we kind of talked about the whole movie, I feel like, in its own way.
In spurts,
like,
yeah.
But, like, we should talk about at least the ending, because...
Well, also the scene where he tries to get the gun out of the truck, the tension in that scene.
Yes, that's
really good.
That's kind of this whole climactic ending.
Okay,
where
this whole part,
because I think all three, the first three have died at this point.
First two,
this is when she dies.
The first two have died.
Oh, yeah, when he gets the gun and shoots her.
Yeah. Because they get themselves out of their
this is maybe what I didn't like about it as much, where it just feels, not cheap horror, but almost just like, you know, normal horror of the guy trying to get the gun before someone can come and get him, you know?
Fair.
And it's just like building tension that way, just to kind of, you know, get the tension there. But he does, you know, he gets the gun, he's trying to load the bullets while she's coming, you know, and then...
Well, no, she's, like, poking him.
Brutal, yeah. Okay, she's poking him in the side. You're right.
It's really bad. I don't know.
Yeah, no, but he's, like, you know, fumbling with the bullets. Like, yeah. I hate that shit, you know.
I see what you're saying.
But it is good. He finally gets the gun loaded, and he shoots her.
No, he doesn't shoot her. She runs off. She runs off. This is what happens. She runs off. He goes back inside the house.
Yeah.
He points the gun at Batista. She comes running in the back door like a mad one, and then he shoots her.
You're right.
He shoots her, and then this is whenever he goes out to confirm what his suspicion that Redmond is the guy that did this to him.
Yes.
You know, he does confirm
with the ID,
it.
Yes,
does confirm it, and I think while he's grabbing the ID, we see Dave Bautista start to do something inside with the other body, because I think this is the moment where Dave Bautista actually kills the girl that's already dying from the gunshot, because she's not completely dead yet, and he still has a job to do, because he's still. There's still the four horsemen of the apocalypse,
yeah,
you know, like, he still has to kill her. No, yeah. He has to kill her and then kill himself.
Yes, kill her and then kill himself.
So, he cuts off her head. I don't know if we see that, because I distinctly remember seeing a shot of him fumbling through, looking for the wallet in Redmond, and we see Dave Bautista doing something through the window inside. Because, like, M. Night shooting outside.
I do remember
that. And
we see the frame,
we see him looking through the window, and I'm pretty sure Dave Bautista is, like, getting his axe ready, basically, or, like, setting her up for the perfect moment to cut her head off, because that's what he does, he cuts her head off.
Yeah.
And that's whenever the next judgment happens.
They locked it. We didn't talk about her, but, like, what I love kind of about this whole event at the end of Bautista kind of just. He's scared that it's happening, but he's doing it as someone who's already seen it in his head.
Yeah.
And that's evidenced really by, it's a little earlier when he starts reading off, I think it's him, that he starts reading off exactly what the newscaster's saying, word for word.
Yep.
Okay.
And it's, like, honestly super creepy, because you're like, oh shit, like, this has literally been in his head that long where he's memorized that, you know?
Yeah.
Like, and that's why it makes this scene so tense, where he kills her, and then once he realizes they're still not going to make the choice until he kills him. himself, basically.
Yeah.
He goes, and he's, like, doing it kind of calm, but still, like, tense.
But
where
don't
he goes
they
out.
Lock him in the bathroom, too, before
they
this?
They do.
Before the,
cause no, he gets out. He escapes through the window, yeah.
Yeah, he escapes through the window. I'm just talking about the very end, where he's, like, basically, he's still gonna die. You know?
Yes,
like,
yes.
Cause that's what's funny. Actually, those scenes do connect, because he does escape through the window, and you think, oh, it might turn into a normal kind of, he's the guy on the outside, the evil guy on the outside who escaped. And
it's the happening with the grandma, the old grandma in the house, when she's outside. It's creepy. Do you not remember that?
Why do I not remember
the happening? When they go to the creepy old grandma's
house,
the happening, and she's outside.
But it's like, nope, Dave Bautista's still just going to beg them to kill them, make the choice, or else he's going to have to die, and then...
Yeah.
You know, he does. He goes out and he just sits on the bench or sits on a chair outside. And how does he? Oh, he takes a knife and just throws it right in front of them. Because in the way he does it, he knows that, like, this is the way it has to be done because this is how I saw it.
Yeah.
You know, and that's the way he's doing it. Because it's like, there's no second guessing of this is how I should do it or anything.
Yeah,
like,
because this is
all
also,
doing it like he's seen it 100 times.
They send, because they're in control of the situation insofar as they're not in danger anymore. Well, they were never in any real danger, actually.
Exactly.
That's the funny part of this whole movie is they're tied up and everything. They were never in any real danger. So
that's what makes their choice even more heartbreaking at the end,
yeah.
right? Because they were never in danger from that.
Yes, because they send, before he slits his throat, they send her, or the daughter, up to the treehouse, where they all built,
so like,
that they built together, so that she doesn't
see
whatever's going to happen.
Yeah, yeah.
And the thing is, the dad that kills him, that's going to end up being the one that dies, says, go up there, whenever you see one of us come up and get you, come back down.
Yes.
Like, he's already made his decision too at this point.
Yeah,
so.
That's a good point.
That's
a really good point. Yeah, he's already accepted it.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
And we see when we finally go back to Rapture, that the scene that's coming up, the one that survives sits right next. You see the shot of him sitting right next to her.
Yeah,
which I thought was cool. But yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, they make the choice that this whole movie is based on.
This part of the movie is definitely the best part.
Okay, I like this choice part.
I actually agree with you.
Yes. And
it's
then,
the most heartfelt moment too. Like, it's,
no, it keeps the stakes real.
Yeah.
You know, because then the choice happens. He goes and gets his daughter.
Yeah.
And then they drive off.
Go to the diner.
They go to a diner.
And they see that everything stopped.
Yeah.
What do you guys think of the final scene with them and the radio?
I kind of like it, honestly.
I thought it was
kind of cute. Because that's just another type of, like, signs type of thing. Like,
it
if
is.
You believe in miracles, like, this song would come on right then? Really? Like, it's just like he's still there with it.
And then the fact that he turns it off.
Okay, so he turns it on.
Yeah.
He turns it off. And then she
the
turns
daughter
it
turns
on.
It on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And looks at his reaction and then turns it off. And then he turns it on.
And then he
turns
it on.
Yes.
Yeah, which is cool. Because you hear that song when they're driving up to the
cabin. It's one of the flashbacks.
Yeah.
It's one of the flashbacks.
It's their song.
Yeah.
You know? It's a good ending.
I do. I actually kind of. It's a sweet ending.
Honestly, this is true for most movies, but the more we talk about it, I'm like, oh, I might.
I know, Like, I actually kind of like Knock of the Cabin more.
I don't like it as much, but.
It's like, there are. Like I said earlier, there
we
are
skipped
moments.
Skipped a lot of the slow parts.
Yes, there are moments in this movie where it does bog down. Like, it's still an hour. It's still an hour. It's an hour 40, honestly. Like, it's an hour 40. It's kind of a long movie.
Yeah.
And it does.
Okay, hour 40 is not long.
No, it's.
For a Signs, it's like hour 45, and that feels short.
But there's more happening inside.
Yeah,
that's
the real
story.
Yeah,
like there's not there are moments of exposition, but this movie is kind of feels like all exposition at some for the most part.
But I am interested to go back and rewatch.
I am too, honestly.
Because one thing I'm interested in is kind of to notice this time to see
the
when each character kind of believes it's happening.
Yeah,
you know.
Well, I mean,
in their own way.
The child believes pretty fast.
Yes,
I think.
Yeah,
the dad that gets a severe concussion believes whenever he sees the ray of light.
Yes.
And I think the other dad doesn't want to believe, but fully believes whenever he smashes the TV. Whenever Dave Bautista is reading the newscast back to them, like before she's even saying it, like the newscaster's even saying it.
Okay.
Because after that scene, like he literally smashes the TV. That's what ends that scene.
Yeah.
He's like, stop doing that.
It's like,
he's like trying to deny it. Yeah.
No. Yeah. No, but I'll definitely need to rewatch this at some point.
Yeah. I mean, like most Shyamalan movies, they do kind of grow on you as you watch them more and more. Because he
does
his movies. He makes them to rewatch them.
His skill as a filmmaker
most great movies should be on that, though.
Yeah, honestly.
His skill as a filmmaker is kind of subtle in a way.
Yeah,
and really, that,
for how over-the-top his stories feel to be sometimes, the way his actual, like, formally he shoots is actually really subtle.
A lot of I said at the beginning I didn't like Old, but I was people were talking about it a lot on Twitter, and people brought up the point that he kind of uses the edge of the frame in Old as, like, the monster. I was thinking,
I even saw a video of that, of him talking about Old, where the two directors that he was really inspired by shooting that was Kurosawa and Bergman.
Yes,
use off-screen space. Panning across characters, too.
He actually studies, I'm pretty sure he actually, like, studies, like, directors, like...
I can see that. I mean, dude, he's really good formally.
And his Twitter bio is, my Mount Rushmore is Kubrick, Kurosawa, Hitchcock and Ray.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Interesting. I'm surprised Hitchcock.
I wonder which Ray.
Probably Soggy G. Ray.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
Nicholas Ray.
I mean, it's definitely Soggy Ray.
Yeah,
it's
definitely
Ray. Come on.
I gotta learn more about that. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
But yeah, damn, that's pretty cool.
I'm surprised you didn't know that already. But,
no, I should have known that.
Yeah, but I guess that
wraps up Shyamalan.
That wraps up our first Shyamalan.
We'll probably come back.
Yeah, we'll definitely come back to him. This is the good thing about him is he's still working, obviously.
Still working,
should have jobs as long as he can afford
Jordan Peele, you know?
Yeah.
Like,
well, I mean, Shyamalan self-finances a lot, so as long as he can afford them, he'll keep on making them. So, so that takes us to our episode next week. We're starting my next series. We're just going to finish Ghibli Part 2.
Is this what do you think? Is this better than part one? Or maybe we'll talk about that next week.
More interesting than part one.
Yeah, like, which one do you like more?
Probably not better. It's hard to say better.
The thing is, like, all the movies we're going to be doing, I love in this series, in this part, too. Maybe besides the gore one. I'm excited to watch from up on Poppy Hill again eventually, but... that's the only Goro one we're going to be doing in this series, but
sadly, I know all the Goro fans out there.
We're not
Earwig and the Witch.
Or Tales from Earthsea is probably worse than Earwig and the Witch, which is something. But yeah, next week we're doing, honestly, these My Neighbor the Yamadas and Spirit Away are what we're doing next week. Two of my favorites of, like, any of the Ghibli movies.
Spirit Away is probably definitely one of my favorites.
My Neighbor's the Yamada is my second-ranked Ghibli movie. Second right now. Only yesterday I moved up to 3 after a rewatch.
My Neighbor's Totoro is
number
1.
Yes.
Okay.
So, obviously, and honestly, My Neighbor Totoro and My Neighbor's the Yamada's very similar movies. Kind of, or not? At least in tone.
You have my attention.
At least in tone. My Neighbor's the Yamada's.
And
My Neighbor's the Yamada's. We'll talk about this more. Yeah, okay, I'll just end the episode. I was just going to say I love the art style of My Neighbor's the Yamadas. But until next week. Exactly. I'll play a ton of state of next week. Okay, so until next week, we hope to see you floating through the clouds.